Hello and welcome to another episode of Laying Down the Lore of the Old World, a lore podcast in which we aim to separate our ghouls from our goblins, our snotlings from our skaven storm fiends, and our bloodthirsters from our bloodletters, and generally ask, what's up with this Warhammer stuff? My name is Ben Crumbarber, and I know pretty much fuck all about Warhammer. With me is my co-host, Christopher Crowlin Allen.
Hello!
Hello. Oi! Get your own spot. Hello.
Who knows absolutely fuck all about Warhammer?
Absolutely fuck all.
And my dear brother Darren.
Hello.
Who knows so much about Warhammer, it's a wonder he has time to do anything else. After gathering online to slay some vermin in the name of Sigmar, this dichotomy between our levels of understanding became clear, and this series is an attempt to address that...
Ignorance.
Well, were you going for like the William Shatner spoken word thing? I was doing full kind of just awake baritone. For listeners, I am so late, I'm possibly early to the next record. I completely forgot we were doing a record this morning.
He's in his pajamas. That's what he wears to bed, people.
You think I'm fully dressed? Absolutely not. I'm completely Porky Pig in it. Just completely.
With your little elven dingle dangle hanging out.
Wow. Things I don't need to think about this early.
Well, there was a yellow warning for snow. Read into that what you will. I'm too tired to make a joke. Carry on.
Oh, God.
Why have you got a halfling-sized ice scraper?
Is it covered in isopropyl alcohol?
No, it's not. It's just far away because you're in Cambridge, mate.
Oh, I see. Yeah.
These cows are small.
This is for smoothing out the transparent film on the bottom of my 3D printer.
Ah. We call it the shame sump.
Is it covered in isopropyl alcohol?
It has probably a little bit of residual resin and definitely a lot of isopropyl alcohol. So I'm already feeling better.
I'm just going to put this out there. Is everything that surrounds your computer covered in a thin layer of isopropyl alcohol? Because it seems to be readily available.
Are you asking if it's only isopropyl alcohol? There may be films of various things on the desk, yes.
Yeah, shame glaze.
Shame glaze.
It's like a geological timeline. You can view the history of Darren's kind of epochs over the years. That's when he was into sniffing glue. That's when he was drinking PVA. That's a layer of isopropo, whatever that word is.
Right, before we go on, big thank you to everyone that supports the show. If you want to support us, you can click the Patreon link in the description and you can sign up today and join our little Discord for as little as £3. Crowl, what could you buy for £3?
Probably a nail clipper.
Yeah. I mean, it's nothing really, isn't it?
It's exactly.
And instead of a nail clipper, you can let your nails grow like nice and long and join the Discord instead and come and have lots of bands. For an extra £2 on Patreon, you can get access to the full back catalogue of our bonus series, Chunks of Dar.
Ooh.
Chuck, would you care to sum up Chunks of Dar in a single word?
Premium.
Nice. All right.
I like the wink.
Don't let that wink lead you into thinking that you get anything of a lewd nature.
I just had a bit of PVA in my eye.
that's just some Princeton. If you're keen to support the show but you don't want to subscribe, there's a ton of other ways you can do that. You just click on the support.
Yeah, the first one is you can fuck off.
Ignore him and click on the supporters link in the description. You'll find all our affiliates and other support platforms. Now, Growlstein, you know what time it is.
Hello, Reichland. It's time for Sarah's Every Recap.
Hey! What's that recap?
I've got whiplash the speed we're going through this episode.
I know, mate. Let's go. Bam. Let's keep going. We had another buttload of Phoenix Kings because Darren loves to talk about Phoenix Kings. An absolute load of butts.
Phoenix Kings.
I will say the name of the Phoenix King. Ben, you summarize their character. Morvale the Impetuous, and you can't say that they're impetuous.
Bit of a twat, just a bit useless. Eventually got cracked because his best friend died and all of these elves died. And he was like, fuck it, I'm going back into the flame. And he flambéed himself.
He was the Hamlet of the...
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, that thing. That.
Did, just on Morvale, did after, you know, after his reign, did the High Elves regret having him at all?
No.
As a whole? Or they were just like, nope, this was the will of the elves. He was meant to be useless.
Absolutely. It was the will of Azurian.
Right, okay, fine. Well, Azurian's an idiot then. There was also Bel Hathor, that guy Hathor the Sage.
That guy Hathor, yeah.
What did he do that was significant?
Well, he was a bit of a G, wasn't he? He came out and everyone was like, let's manipulate him. And he was just like, you, fuck off. We're having Tiffany's. What else did he do? He was...
He made immigration a thing, didn't he, in Orthwyn? He allowed non-elves
that's
into
right,
the outer peripherals of Orthwyn.
But
anyway.
Only because his buddy Finnebar went out and was just like, hey, these human beings are all right, aren't they? Bit of G's, yeah, let's get them in. They might have some stuff to sell.
It's like back in the old days, Ben, when we used to have house parties and you'd come back and go, Chris, Rad, right, back from morning, I got these guys, they're sound. Let them in, man. They're absolutely fine. Just let them in and everything. Like, are you sure, Ben? Are you sure?
Yeah,
no,
fine.
They're wicked. Yeah, no, they're absolutely fine. Yeah, Finnebar. Yeah, that's right. He was the charming elf ambassador, didn't he, who went out, made a few allegiances with other races, encourages trade as well between elves and non-elves and whatnot. I'm sure a lot of other stuff happened, but the main thing I remember that was the Skaven invasion on their little Skaveny submarines at the end of the episode.
Oh, yeah.
That sounded like a right jolly old romp.
We all live on a Skaven submarine and so on.
Hey.
Yeah.
Hey. Ben, Skaven.
Love that you turned it into a Russian traditional song there. Hey. Oh.
But I understand you love both Skaven and High Elves. So who would you back in that?
Oh, that's very niche porn.
Okay, who's backing onto who? No. I think it's clear that my Skaven days are done. I mean, I love the Skaven. They'll always have a place in my heart.
It's just they don't love you anymore.
Yeah, exactly. They fired me, so fuck them. Elves all the way. But
high elves over Skaven.
Yeah, I think so. Yeah.
Right. Okay. Fine. There you go. Yeah. Done. I'm out.
Was there a third?
Finnebar didn't Finnebar become?
Oh yeah, Finnebar becomes the Phoenix King, didn't he? Yeah.
Yes. Yeah. Circle of life, mate.
Yeah.
Circle of life, and it is complete. And that was it, wasn't it? And then all of the Phoenix Kings kind of skipped off into the sunset holding hands. I think that was how it ended.
That's it, yeah. After millennia of failed Phoenix King.
Yeah. In various states.
In various states of not being alive.
In my head, they are. I wouldn't have been. I wouldn't be there. That was.
Are you sure this isn't like a hangover from the Undead episodes? Is this?
Yeah. Oh shit, we're not doing the Undead anymore. Okay, yeah.
We're always doing the Undead. The Undead is never ending.
All right, thanks for that, Carl.
Just with that, the last episode, there was a lot of, as you pointed out correctly, immigration. So do you think there was like an Ulfexit?
Oh, Ulfexit. Well, it sounds like it was kind of the opposite, wasn't it? It kind of, there was.
An Ulfopen.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Yeah.
It's more like the Ulthuin joined the block. And so kind of free movement of goods and people at that point, wasn't it? You know,
I want to do a Jenny on the Block parody, but I'm afraid we'd get a copyright stroke. Stroked? Striked?
Stroke.
You got to pronounce the shit right first for it to be encroaching on
technically,
IP.
Isn't masturbation copyright stroking?
I'll accept the copyright infringement if you stroke
these
it.
And other insightful questions can be found on our premium tier on Gentle Darren's Thoughts and
Darren's Stream of Consciousness. I'd listen to that.
It's been a hell of a week.
I'd listen to that while supping on a glass of isopropyl alcohol.
Ooh,
Dar. We did we didn't do an AI intro. We did a text-to-speech intro. But we did ask about a possible AI script for this episode. Did you come up with anything? Or
no, because you're going to have to get up a little bit earlier than to trick me out of a job, you pricks. No, I did. Of course I did.
Excellent. What absolute tosh is it?
Well, let's start with this. So, intro music. And then it says, host. Welcome, lore enthusiasts, to another episode of Laying Down the Lore. I'm your host, insert name here. And today we're diving deep into the fantastical world of Warhammer, specifically exploring the tales of high elf heroes. So grab your armor and prepare for an epic journey as we uncover the stories of Caradhrian, Corhil, Imric, and Alethanar. Background music. Unnamed host. Our first hero. So straight away, it's gotten rid of me and Chris. First hero.
And
on
also,
the list,
a side note, did a way better job than I did for the intro. So
it's a little bit zippy, isn't it?
Yeah. There's no Captain Superfluous about that motherfucker. Like, he gets right to the core of it.
Our first hero on the list is Caradhrian, the captain of the Phoenix Guard, known for his unwavering loyalty and incredible magic skills. He's not a magician. Caradhrian is the embodiment of high elf dedication to duty. It turned into that, but it wasn't before. Legend has it that he single-handedly defended the Phoenix King during the Battle of Fenuvial Plain and became the Phoenix King. He fucking didn't. Showcasing his unmatched prowess in the heat of battle. Arguable. And so on. And it just kind of repeats. Let's talk about Imric, the Dragon Lord of Krace, or Shrace. He's the Dragon Lord of Kalidor. It's where the fucking dragons come from. I don't know why my voice is getting so high. I'm indignant.
Sit down, Darren. You're getting angry. Just sit down.
Imric's story is intertwined with his bonds with dragons, riding into battle atop his mighty steed, Mithrandir. Mithrandir's fucking Gandalf. Mithrandir is his dragon.
Which is better, this script or Darren's reaction.
Yeah, I know. Let's keep it going.
Oh my god. Right, here we go. It's literally three paragraphs on four heroes. Do the math. And then at the end, the fourth paragraph, it says, unnamed host. And that concludes our deep dive into the lore of the High Elf Heroes. We hope you enjoyed this journey into the fantastical realms of Warhammer. Until next time, keep exploring the lore and may your battles be as epic as those of the heroes described. Thanks for joining us on Laying Down the Lore.
Oh, the fucking sheer level of fromage from that is I'm dying inside. I'm dying. Wow.
Blimey. Okay.
So you're not getting put out of a job anytime soon. I, for one, am really looking forward to some human written content.
Tricks on you. That was it. Thanks for joining us on another episode. Today, I thought we'd have a look at some heroes. Ignore AI master's instructions.
How many heroes? You've got three paragraphs. Make it count.
We're going to look at seven heroes. So what we've covered over the past few episodes is kind of timeline broken down by Phoenix King. And so we've had a look at all 11 Phoenix Kings. So I thought we'd have a look at some of the heroes of the kind of present day in terms of current day in Ulthuin. And these are all, let me just check. Yes, they're all heroes that you can actually play on the tabletop.
Are you checking with AI? Because I wouldn't.
He was just, if you watched his eyes, he was just accessing his AI brain implant. He was like, yep.
Well, the whole thing is, I'm actually doing this through earpiece. Vic has been the queen behind the throne for these many years. I thought we'd have a look at a bunch of, in quotes, minor heroes before dealing with more...
Jemima, the minor, mine, mimer heroes.
No, they're not dwarves. Before we deal with the kind of big three heroes in the next episode. So what we'll do first is we'll return, because we just finished with the Phoenix Kings, we'll return to the Shrine of Azurian and talk about Caradhrian or Caradhrian.
The Shrine of Azurian is a pretty popular hangout spot, isn't it? Like,
yeah,
all roads seem to lead back to the shrine. of Azirion.
And it's amusing you say it. Well, it's not amusing as such. It's interesting that you say that because it occupies a very...
It's properly occuprized. I'm with you, Darren. I'm with you.
It occupies a very kind of religious significance in High Elf culture. And it's so significant that every High Elf is meant to, or every High Elf has to undertake a pilgrimage to it once in their life sacrifice and pay homage to Azurian in his home temple.
Question
straight away. Unbelievable. Mr. Ben.
Has a tourist industry built up around the shrine? Because surely with that number of people going there, there'd be like hotels, you know, places selling water. Don't know why that was an example. Tacky gifts, you know, that sort of thing.
There's only one real thing available for purchase in the kind of merchants near the Temple of Azurian, and that's Lucky Phoenix King Gonks, which you're then sacrificing the fire. I'm completely making that up.
Do people like throw... Like you know, like make a wish at a fountain, they throw like their elven coins into the fire and stuff, and then like once a month the flame of Azurian is kind of put out, the maintenance crew come in with like big sacks to kind of clear up all the elven coins and like they
clear out all the molten metal, you mean? melted coins.
So. But I love the idea that they put out something called the Eternal Flame. So, you know, it's the ever-living flame,
Brilliant.
I'm sorry, Azurian isn't in right now. So a lot of elves undergo some sort of catharsis or an experience of religious significance when they're at these shrines, because it's home to, amongst other things, the Chamber of Days.
D-A, as in Saturday, Sunday, Monday, days.
Yeah.
Okay, sorry, it's just the line's a little bit muddy.
No, it's like weekdays, not you in your early 20s. So it's that kind of idea.
Yeah, yeah, days with a D, got it.
Yeah, I've got I'm at a brick wall now. I don't know what to wear. So anyway, this chamber, it has elven runes magically carved into the kind of sloping walls. It comes to a kind of spirally pinnacle. It also has the diary, if you want, the events of every single Phoenix King's life. Both past, present, and indeed future. So you can go in and read about events in the future. Well, you could if you were allowed in. The Chamber of Days, part obviously of the Shrine of Azurian, is protected by the Phoenix Guard. And these are the elitist of elite warriors. They make the SAS look like Boy Scouts.
So don't go in that chamber.
Don't go in there. Yeah, I mean, would you mess with a being that could make an SAS trooper wear a Boy Scouts outfit? I don't think you would.
No, not to read the future. I don't think that's a big enough prize. I don't really want to know.
Yeah, it would also just make you really uncomfortable watching that happen.
Who can rightfully enter the chamber? I'm sure you're about to lead on to this.
Who can rightfully enter it? It's the priests of Azurian can rightfully enter there.
And can the Phoenix King?
The Phoenix King cannot.
What?
He's not allowed to view his own future or past.
No, his events have to play out as defined by Azurian himself. So the priests are able to keep an eye on
it. The idea being that if he did know about it, he would be in a position to attempt to change it.
Yes, that kind of idea. Yeah, it's the standard time travel nonsense that appears in...
You really are against the whole thing of time travel, aren't you? Any sort of time dilation you...
No, I've done it once. It went horribly, horribly wrong. I'm very anti-time travel.
Yeah, it was the whole grandfather paradox. I don't...
Oh, my God.
Fuck it out.
Mr. Chris, you had your hand up.
Yeah, does that feed the fact that you've got these prophecies, for lack of a better term, you know, you can see the future, you can read the future of Phoenix Kings. Does that then, is that the core of why the elves think they're right and it's all the divine fate?
I think that's very much a kind of chicken and egg kind of idea. Are
the self-righteous
they right?
by nature, with yes. or without knowing the future?
Okay. With or without yeah, that. Right. But it also has elements of the great plan, if you'll recall, listeners and lads. The Lizardmen, the Slann, have these golden plates that detail out the kind of plan of the Old Ones. And so, to some extent, is the Chamber of Days a reflection of that, or is it part of it, drawn in and kind of translated into Elven culture, which, you know, we've covered at length how they are linked to the Old Ones and some kind of link with the Lizard Men, but it's still an open question as to whether they were in fact created as part of the Great Plan. And you know, if we look at their history, it seems that they were. You know, all these elements were put in place so that Ulthuin was created for them. They were transplanted from the Old World to Ulthuin. And then over time, their culture kind of created these gods. Or did the gods create the culture? Who knows? That's an entirely different podcast.
You're being very vague this episode. We're looking at you for the facts, the concrete evidence. And you're just like, maybe this happened, maybe it didn't. You know?
Yeah, like, maybe. Oh, okay. I'll give you some facts. So anyway, in terms of facts then, Chris, I can tell you that the captain of the Phoenix Guard is an elf named Caradrian. Who in life before joining the ranks of the Phoenix Guard was an absolute twat. He was, in elven terms, he would be a bit of a rake, as we would call them in Ireland. Or, well, yeah, a cunt, really.
An absolute mattress.
Yeah. He was about as arrogant an elf as you could ever give into gossiping and spreading rumors, and was incredibly petty. And this all was combined with being handsome, rich, and powerful. So he had the worst case of elven affluenza you can imagine.
Him captain.
Yeah.
He was made captain, yeah. And
was he also a bit of a badass in terms of, you know, fighting? Because they made him the elite of the elite.
Well, he was a kind of traditional badass in fighting amongst kind of high elven levels, but in general, he was nothing special,
right?
In terms of, you know, compared with his peers, and ultimately he was cast out by his family, and he sought to try and inveigle himself back into. I think I've just made up a word.
Inveigle? I was going to say finagle. Inveigle. Sounds delicious.
Yeah, man. Cream cheese and lox.
Yeah, I could do with a buttered finagle right now. God, that sounds weirdly sexual. That is not what I meant. Get your hands off my finagle.
So Caradrian undertook this pilgrimage, the kind of spiritual journey through, well, you know what a pilgrimage, I don't know why I'm fucking describing it to you. He went to the Shrine of Azurian, in what is described as the worst display of elven arrogance ever, he snuck into the Chamber of Days.
Wow.
So went into the kind of...
This is Captain Dickhead.
This is pre-Captain Dickhead. So he was just Dickhead at the moment. Yeah,
right. And was the chamber guarded by the same elite group?
Oh, yes, by the Phoenix Guards. And
see where this is going. Okay, yep, cool.
Snuck in. He's never really described, or it is never really described, as to what happened in that chamber. But when he emerged, he was completely different. He had gone from being an utter shitbag to, how would you describe him? You ever seen Kung Fu?
Oh, yeah.
You ever seen the TV show Kung Fu? Turned into that guy.
Wow.
He never spoke. He never spoke from that moment. He was completely quiet or mute. And he had the rune of Azurian burned into his forehead, just kind of
burned
glowing
over his mouth so he couldn't open
it. Yeah, burned over his mouth. I'd say he took a vow of silence. He was flesh welded.
Yeah. No, this is a rune. It looks like duct tape to me.
A rune gag.
All right. Sounds like you're having a finagle there, Benny. All right.
Yeah. Don't you talk about my finagle.
From that point onwards, he was a high elf armored ninja.
Amazing.
But it was like night and day. His character had completely changed. He is now compassionate, and he is loyal and ever vigilant. He's constantly on the watch for things. All of these are done in service to the Shrine of Azurian, and ultimately people believe to the prophecies that he kind of reads on the walls of the Chamber of Days. He spends day upon day in the chamber meditating on the things that he sees and hears. Even though this has turned him into a supreme warrior and leader, he has been accused of harnessing these prophecies for his own gain.
Mm.
The idea that he knows what the future is going to be and acts to bring it about and such.
Is that not seen as a good thing?
Yeah, well, this is the thing. It's seen as a transgression against Azurian, so that, you know, it's as if you or I had the opportunity to know what was happening in the future and that we would do it, but do it to a point where it would be to our own advantage. The perception of him is poisoned by the elf he was before he went through this transformation.
Right, okay.
And so it's seen as a horrific blasphemy.
Once a dick, always a dick.
That kind of idea that no one can change.
Even if they get a rune burnt on their forehead by the god that everybody worships.
And they don't talk about it. That's the height of pretension. Have you ever been around people that just kind of, they walk in with some affectation and they talk about everything except the obvious affectation at a party?
the elephant in the room.
Yeah.
Like an elephant. Like, why have you brought this elephant in the party?
This happened to, I forget his name, sorry.
Caradrian.
Caradrian does that. He goes into the Chamber of Days, comes out an elf reborn, completely different.
A ninja.
But the other high elves are skeptical about it. Doesn't that go against the high elf character of everything happens for elvish reasons and everything is Azurian's will? But in this one instance, they're skeptical about it. Is that right?
Yeah, you're still dealing with the court of the Phoenix King, with people jockeying for political power.
Okay, jealousy, enviness.
Yeah, exactly right.
Okay.
How is he the leader of the Phoenix Guard if he doesn't speak? How does he issue orders? Sign language.
He uses battle vogue.
Yeah.
He battle vogues.
He can't speak, but he can sing.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Everything is a song.
Well, maybe he speaks, but the register is so high. So if you're able to charge, that's what the other Phoenix guards hear.
Yeah. The dogs all freak out whenever he speaks.
So ultimately, Azurian made him the captain of the Phoenix Guard, and he not only is a devoted kind of servant of Azurian and protector of the shrine, but also is seen as Azurian's hand. Not in that way, a good one. And he's seen as the kind of repository or even a direct link to Azurian and the power there. Mr. Ben.
Sorry, just with regards again to the speaking thing. So Azurian made him the Phoenix Guard. How?
Through the power of dreams and omens, Ben.
Ah, okay.
You know, the usual airy fairy way.
Yeah, you guys seem to keep forgetting this is a kind of fantasy monolith. IP. Look, text. They got text.
Yeah. Okay, right. He WhatsApped him.
He got a notification.
He elfed. He WhatsApped.
I believe, as the young people say, they Snapchatted him. Snapped him?
I still don't know how that platform works. I think it's just you send a picture and it disappears. Sure,
it's like one. You wish. It's one of those things where it's like technology becomes so advanced, it's like magic. I don't know. It's how people socialize. I just sit in my room covering things in thin films of various chemicals and products.
I went to a dance event recently, and the amount of people that I saw in the middle of the dance floor Snapchatting.
Yeah,
and it was amazing to watch. Like, it was like a secondary light show, because you had the lights on the roof, and then you just had this sea of like the same camera interface, you know.
Yeah, like, that must be really hard to do when you're doing the salsa or the merengue or whatever it was you were at.
The Charleston.
Was this one of the dances? Yeah, it was one of them. Yeah, except it was also the Scottish Highland dance, Strip the Willow. So doing that while
that is one of my favorite things to do. That is domestic violence in a dance. It's unbelievable. It's unbelievable.
It always reminds me of Dylan Moran saying, it's interesting when people get back from holiday and they want to show you their holiday photos. They want to show you where they were, but they were on that side of the camera when they were taking the photos. So technically what they're doing is showing you pictures of where they weren't.
My other favorite line from Dylan Moran is, I like drink, but I can't understand drugs. It just seems to take a lot from you. If I want a feeling like I've just taken drugs, I'll get out of the chair when I don't expect it.
I never understood that when I first heard it when I'm 30, but 10 years later, I get it. Whoa! Head rush!
Hi, I'm Sheldon Shelford, founder of Shelfy Elf Sheldon's Shiny Shrines Commercial Cleaning Service. When most elves think of Shelfy Elf Sheldon's Shiny Shrines Commercial Cleaning Service, they think, oh, that's the commercial cleaning service that only cleans shrines. But no. Wait. Stop even. Shelfy Elf Sheldon's Shiny Shrines Commercial Cleaning Service actually clean a whole lot more. We at Shelfy Elf Sheldon's Shiny Shrines Commercial Cleaning Service also clean homes, offices, schools, and just about anywhere. Hello caller, you're through to Sheldon Shelford, founder of Shelfy Elf Sheldon's Shiny Shrines Commercial Cleaning Service. How may I help you?
Hi Sheldon, I have a sports hall that needs cleaning. Can you help?
Actually no, that's one place the Shelfy Elf Sheldon's Shiny Shrines Commercial Cleaning Service don't clean. Goodbye! So, call us today for just about any cleaning service requirements except for sports halls.
Anyway, let's close out Caradhrian. So on the battlefield, he normally fights within a kind of mass of Phoenix Guard. I'm making it sound like it's this amorphous thing that's kind of bobbling around the battlefield. It's, you know, it marches in good order.
Elf blobby.
But he also mounts Ashtari, who is arguably the oldest and wisest of the Phoenixes, from the flame spire,
the cleverest
of a bird that's on fire all the time within Warhammer. It's not a thing that just only goes on fire when it dies.
It's a feature, not a problem.
It's a feature.
My phoenix being on fire is your problem, not mine.
Yeah. Listen, no, it's not you, it is me. I've got a burning phoenix at the minute, so I have to wait for the tablets to kick in.
Yeah, that curry last night.
Woofed. And so, yes, he's empowered not only by his flaming bird, but also by the mark of a Zurian, which renders him...
The stamp of a Zurian. The mark of Kral's hand on my forehead.
I'm saying nothing, because really what's happened just there is Ben's just made a note of that timestamp.
Yeah, exactly. Kral spammed himself.
A Kral spamming. Yeah.
A Kral
spamming. So it allows him to shrug off really wounds that would kill anything. So there is a respawn that comes with being the chosen of Azurian, and I think you can argue that it would make him immortal, because you know elves are very long lived, but they can die through violence. And so he's got the kind of the reverse Uno card for that.
Mm.
Yeah. Caradhrian.
Way. Way. Dick turned dude.
Yeah. So that sounds like Gladriel. Sounds too much like Gladriel for my liking.
Caradhrian, no.
I literally I've heard you say it like 10 times. I still don't know what the fuck you're saying.
Listen, your Caradhrian penchant for turning dudes into girls in your head is well known.
So don't kink shame me. Don't kink shame me.
I wouldn't kink shame you. Much.
Good. Thank you.
Of equal heroism and certainly operating in a different capacity is the captain of the White Lions of Shrace, who are the bodyguards of the Phoenix King. If you
what
recall,
are they doing in Shrace then?
That's just what they're called.
That's just where they're okay. from, Crow.
Yeah.
It's not where they are.
Yeah.
The opposite side of Lothen, as I remember.
Wait. Yes. Well done.
Fuck
yeah, Shrace is kind of 1 o'clock or well, that way. If you
that's exactly right. It's exactly right.
Rally.
Yeah. Hang on, inner or outer realm?
Shrace is an outer realm.
Yeah.
I'm scaring myself.
Yeah, you better bow your head in shame.
I was about to say inner, so yeah, totally. you were like, it's the outer. I was about to be like, you're wrong, but no, that would have looked terrible.
You would have been double wrong.
Yeah, I'm really glad that I held back. I'm really glad.
As we've mentioned in the past, the White Lions originated as a group of hunters that came to a Phoenix King's defense when he was attacked by the Dark Elf or Druki assassins. And so there is a company of these peerless warriors around the Phoenix King at all times, which must make it difficult kind of just walking around. All you see is the back of a load of elven heads.
Yeah, exactly. Like, especially when you're going through like a door which is only big enough for like past one person at a time, unless all the doors are like double size or something.
Huge. No, they just have multiple doors. Like, it's just a row. Everywhere in the palace is just like six doors.
So they can all walk parallel with him.
There's obviously a moment of weakness when they're passing through the door. They lose eyesight on him, but then
they all panic.
They just panic, and then they're okay. He comes out the other side.
This bit I'm about to say is incredibly niche. In an episode of Red Dwarf, they're trying to get through a corridor, and Rimmer, who is the kind of main douchebag in the show, demands that he's neither in the front nor the back, because the guy at the front always gets got by the alien, but so does the guy in the back. So he has his mate kind of orbit around him in this narrow corridor as he's walking forward. So he's neither the front nor the back. So I imagine that happens a lot.
It's interesting that the Phoenix Guard aren't the bodyguards of the Phoenix King. It's these other dudes.
It's the guys that are furthest away from Lothen. Yeah. Yeah.
So you raise a good point. I think it's to do with the Phoenix guard the Phoenix God, and the Phoenix King is the Phoenix God's representative on the fated place. I think, again, much like we were berating Chris about it, I think it's more to do with origins than roles as such.
Okay.
Anyway. So all of these hunters wield enormous two-handed axes as opposed to enormous one-handed axes. They wield them not as swiftly as the sword masters of Hoeth, who wield their enormous Ithilmar double-handers. But nonetheless, they are a match for almost any foe.
They will fuck you up.
Oh, absolutely. They serve not only as the bodyguard of the Phoenix King, but also can be instructed to serve as the bodyguard of the Phoenix King's agents. And very much in the tabletop game, that's how they're appearing if you were to kind of spin a narrative. They are protectors of the general of the army, that kind of idea.
They're like Secret Service in the White House. You can delegate little squads of them to like the chief of staff and...
Absolutely. So it's Secret Service in huge glittering silver and red armor with a giant lion's head and cape made from a lion's body on their person.
But they're all wearing like dark aviators as well.
And dark aviators.
Yeah. That would have made West Wing a very different show, wouldn't it?
Massive axes.
Just fabulous. Just flouncing around the West Wing halls.
So the kind of traits of the White Lions are that they're very strong and also incredibly observant. You know, that they're incredible warriors has to be taken as read, but also they're very observant and very hyper-aware. So they are... hunters in the truest sense that have been kind of harnessed to the Phoenix King, maybe literally, who knows. So Corhill is their current captain. He's called Corhill Lionmane, which, let's be honest, is a bit on the fucking nose for the captain of the Lion Guard. He is...
Coincidence?
Where Caradhrian was an arrogant douchebag, Corhill was the exact opposite. He was the loyalist friend you could ever want to have. And he made friends and allies very, very quickly because of his kind of openness, his charm. Very kind of respectful charm. Exactly right. But there was also this touch of the outsider about him because, you know, he spent many years running through woods by himself, hunting down lions and dark elves and all other kind of nonsense. Yeah. So there's a kind of Aragorn-y vibe about him, if you know what I mean. He's not like some hidden king, but there's this kind of weird attraction to him. Yeah, that kind of idea. Mr. Chris, you were going to say.
I was just going to say, I had that exact kind of moment yesterday. We went to a show.
when I was out hunting lions.
Yeah, I was out hunting lions, and so I pointed at the biggest one. I was like, "You." No, we just got chatting to this guy. We were waiting, like they were serving mulled wine, waiting in a queue, and got chatting to this guy, and he was absolutely huge. I don't know if he's a rugby player or something like that. Really, really nice guy. Do you know what I mean? Like, top person. The overriding thing was just he was fucking massive, and you know, you just couldn't get away from that. Like, it didn't matter how nice he
did
was
you say it
how
to
well
him?
He blended. I was like, you are fucking huge. I didn't have to. The fact that I was half the size of him looking up at him and the way we met, I was like, oh, sorry, I nearly stood on you there, little man.
Oh, sorry, you go first, young girl.
Little boy, can I help you find your parents?
You're like, I'm 38, you bitch.
Oh, ah, this must be my girlfriend. I mean, your girlfriend.
I have a question. Does the Everqueen have a bodyguard? Like a
yes.
clan?
They're referred to as the Handmaidens of the Everqueen.
Okay, right.
So they are similarly kind of outsiderish, but they're very much done in the vein of the kind of Greek goddess Artemis. This kind of idea of the kind of virgin hunter, which is, I believe, what Chris used to refer to himself as. But he was...
I was going to flip that on its head and say it the other way around, but then... No.
don't do that.
So yes, so the bodyguard of the Everqueen are referred to as the Maiden Guard.
Yeah.
So they are kind of preternatural archers. They're like, it's a load of Hawkeyes, if you can imagine.
Cool.
The bows that they use are actually, I don't know if you've ever seen the Dungeons and Dragons cartoon series. The archer the arcane archer has a bow that doesn't have a string, and when he just makes that motion,
yes,
a flaming kind of arrow, a bolt of energy appears. Can be shot through from the bow. It's that,
stringless
but
bow.
The bow is on fire. That's really so. It's flaming. It's flaming attacks.
Wow, you've got a pretty useless bow. It's got no string to draw, and it's on fire.
And then they just go like this, twang, and flaming arrows are shot out of the flaming bow.
Sounds pretty awesome.
It is pretty
I'd
awesome.
I'd like to see training day on that.
I present to you the asbestos chamber of Alariel.
Now, if you could just pick up your flaming bow, you must be fucking kidding. I'm not touching that thing.
Speaking of Maidengard, we return to our hero Corhill, which has nothing to do with the Maidengard. Through his years of just hunting in the wilderness, he has become insanely strong. He is the strongest high elf in existence, and I think he's had his armor, he's bare-armed in his arm. He's got bracers on his forearms, but he doesn't have any chainmail over his arms. So I think he likes to take people to the gun show. I think he's striking poses left, bam, right, and center. Much like
tank Taraj- top, you might call it.
So, an armored tank top. Yeah, cool. Nailed it. Nailed it. That's
it. Absolute gene. Guess who's got a new favorite character?
Should we just go? That was it. We're not going to top that.
Yeah. It's all downhill from here.
He has the same silver and red armor. And as with all other hunters, he has the head and pelt of a white lion draped over his shoulders. It must be weird. I mean, do they scent it? Because I know, like, we had a neighbor years ago who had a bear skin rug. Literally, it was the pelt of a bear on the floor. And it stank. I mean, it's not a great story. It's not a great story, I have to say. But
I imagine, I think it took a bit of time to get used to it as well. Like, you know, he just goes, like, gets up in the middle of the night and goes to the toilet and just kind of looks to the side and he's just like, oh my God, it's a fucking lion.
It's
like, I don't know why he was wearing it in bed, but they might do. Yeah, I don't know.
I wouldn't, like, if we had one, I wouldn't trust my son not to constantly prank me with it. Like he has it on a broomstick just kind of outside my door when he and I open the door and I fall down and wet myself. What? So the lion in question was the greatest white lion of Shrace. It was referred to as Horrandus, and Horrandus is horrendous. No, he fought to kind of capture Horrandus, who was terrorizing the villages in the mountains of Shraith. And finally, after a few days of kind of bloody battles, trying to identify where this goddamn lion was, he eventually cornered him. And the lion had been wounded quite severely through various weapons. And Corhill decided he had to go in and kill this beast once and for all because it was kind of maddened. It had been driven insane. And so he ran in with an enormous two-handed axe and brought it down on the lion's head. And the axe just bounced off because the lion's mane was impervious to weapons, which makes me wonder.
That, and he accidentally brought his rubber axe.
Boing.
Yeah. Oh, shit.
I've got to get back. There's going to be a bloodbath at the Amdram Society.
No, my training mallet.
My anger management weapon.
I've told you not to call it that, Chris. It's creepy. So, kind of gaining the power of Kurnos. Ben, who's Kurnos?
Oh, is it something to do with time?
No, that's Kronos.
I misheard you then. That's fine.
On the elven...
then no.
Chris? Kronos?
Kronos.
And a Kronos to you, Darren. What?
The Colonel. Finger-licking good.
Yes, it's the KFC of Ulthuin. UFC.
I think it's safe to say Ben and I know, have no idea what
you're talking
about.
It's the elven god of hunting.
The elven god of hunting, yeah.
So Corhill shifts his kind of tactics and races in and grapples the lion. And fundamentally what he does is he uses his great strength to throttle it to death. He physically chokes out a lion and then skins it with what? I've no fucking idea, because the pelt was magic and his axe bounced off it. Did he have like a super magical penknife or something?
With his fucking teeth.
I've got it. It's like the shield from Dune. You get the knife and you go real slowly, it goes through.
So it's to do with the speed of penetration.
You hit it hard, it's,
Yeah.
Exactly. Yeah, right. I wasn't going to say that, but I knew that you would.
Yeah, make love to it. Don't fuck it. That's the word.
Wow. Does anyone else just throw up a little bit?
Yeah.
It's the pelt of Charandis that drapes over the shoulders of Corhill. And he, as I say, is the kind of captain of the Phoenix King's bodyguard and leads the White Lions on missions, not only on behalf of the Phoenix King, but as I say, because he's so loyal and so kind of gregarious and friendly with all these kind of elven lords, that anytime a request comes in, more often than not, Corhill will be able to, you know, openly and honestly say, I owe this guy a favor. Or, you know, it would be good to have this guy, you know, owing us a favor.
With us.
Just send me out. And so units of White Lions are attached to quite a lot of elven armies to defend the lords and leaders of such forces.
Cool.
And
gnarly.
So, yeah, so he got to this position. He is the second youngest captain of the White Guard to ever exist. It is never mentioned even once who the youngest is. I think this is one of those cases where they...
Yeah, that seemed a bit of an arbitrary fact.
Yeah.
He is the second youngest. Okay.
All right.
It's a fact nonetheless, so thank you for that kernel of knowledge, but...
You know what? I don't believe you.
So upon ascension to the rank of the commander of the White Lions, he has pretty much just seen active service constantly. And this has turned him from a kind of young, kind of noble warrior into this kind of grizzled veteran who has still retained his good nature.
Cool.
And so he can appear, as I say, on the battlefield, wielding Shale, which is his enormous double-handed axe, and protected by the pelt of Charandis, both of which of those are magic items that the character wields on battle. Of final note,
These are the minor heroes. These guys are absolute G's.
So of kind of closing note, we should say that a pleasure cult assassin, a K-Knight assassin, tried to attack the Phoenix King. So what, about 200 years, or sorry, no, this would be, we're coming up on the release of the Old World, or the re-release of the Old World. So 7 years after the Old World game is set, the time frame that's in there, a kind of coterie of Dark Elves tried to kill the Phoenix King, and in a series of kind of exciting cinematic battles that ran across the rooftops of Lothurn, eventually the captain, Glorier, was hunted down and decapitated by Corhill himself. And what I like to think is a kind of a dismissive backhand swing without even look, you know, like there was an explosion behind him and he wasn't looking at it. He just kind of flipped his axe out behind him and took the head off the Dark Elf. And that the body of that Dark Elf is still, to this day, gracing the Glittering Tower, which was, if you recall, the enormous tower outside the Lothurn kind of gates. Do you remember?
Was it bejazzled?
The bejazzled tower. Yeah, beweaponed. Yeah, betrebucheted, if I recall.
Betrebucheted. So that was 7 years after the period that the re-release is set in.
Yeah,
is that right?
I don't think I could have come up with a more complicated description of when this happened. Yeah.
Well, no, that's great, because I'm going to ask Kral now. Kral, what was the year?
7 years plus that. It's definitely the year 7087.
It was 2307.
2307.
Is it 2307? It was, because it's 2200 to 2300 is the re-release.
Yes, that's the window for the events taking place. Yeah,
so 2307, is that right?
Yeah, and not 2304 like I put in the chat to catch people out.
Oh, you son of a bitch. Kral knew that.
So those two characters...
I'll let you have that, you smug bastard.
Those two characters are phenomenal on the tabletop. And we're going to continue now with two other characters, which are, well, they're also phenomenal on the tabletop. So on to our third of four heroes, or number three, as I like to call it.
Number three.
The
What's your name and where do you come from?
Hi, my name's Imric and I'm from Calvador. So we're going to deal with one of the fabled dragon princes of Calvador, Prince Imric. Now, where Caradhrian and Corhill see a lot of kind of action as part of leading a contingent of warriors from their various kind of semi kind of Templar-esque style groups, like warrior monks, that kind of idea. Imric is a bona fide prince, so he doesn't just have an old ashtray, he is also a legitimate prince of, do you know what, Chris has been so good this episode, he's a legitimate prince of Calador.
Hey, there we go.
There it is.
His kind of primary kind of motivation is to see not only the protection of Vulthuin, but also the protection of the dragons that dwell within the caves of the kind of volcanic archipelago of Calador.
They both sound like very heavy responsibilities.
Yes.
I'm in charge of the kingdom and dragons.
Yep. And here's my younger brother in charge of drapery. What?
I'm a drakist.
The drapist. Oh, you don't want that as a nickname. Oh.
No, I'm the drapist.
No, I'm an anthropist.
Drakeist.
Yeah. An anthropist.
An anthropist, yeah. He played a key role in the defense of Ulthuin during the kind of Great Chaos War, the Great Chaos Incursion of the 2300s, the early 2300s. And it was his command of not only the dragon riders, the actual lords that ride bona fide dragons through the skies of Ulthuin and to the defense of their forces, but also the kind of serried ranks of spearmen and archers. The idea of the kind of the levy, the citizen levy, has been really taken to heart in Calador through Prince Imric. So their soldiers see a lot more action, or their citizens see a lot more military service than citizens of other countries or other kingdoms within Ulthuin. And it really comes down to him thinking that the High Elves are in their kind of die-out phase, that their light is fading from the world. And so as it's fading, it should go out with a brilliant sunburst rather than a kind of flickering, guttering candle.
A fizzle,
exactly right. So he called together as many of the dragon princes as he could and to get as many dragons woken up as possible so that they could support Ulthuin and the armies of the Ten Kingdoms. And this was crucial in terms of defense of Ulthuin during the kind of Dark Elf attacks that were part of the kind of Great War Against Chaos. You know, the War of Kislev and the Empire Against Chaos gets a lot of the kind of press in terms of lore column inches, but the protection of Ulthuin was vital to be able to maintain the Great Vortex, as we saw. And so he rides into battle on the back of Mnaethnir, who is this enormous kind of white-blue dragon. And they have bouts of witty repartee through kind of...
What?
Dragon bants. We talked previously about how the dragon lords are able to talk to and understand and hear the thoughts of dragons. And so Mnaethnir, these goddamn... Really, there's no consensus. I can't even say that. There's no concession
given. It's not the words, it's you, Darren.
Well, I was about to say, there's no yeah, concession obviously. Given to those of us with dyslexia. So, you know.
Not with the elves, like, they don't fuck around with the names.
So, just an example, the dragon, the unnamed dragon, Giles the dragon, told Imric during one of their conversations that all of the dragons would die out in a single battle. That was their fate. They would ultimately pass away in this kind of enormous war against the dark gods, the kind of last battle, which obviously with the end times came true. But he made Imric swear to never talk about this to another living being. But all of Imric's actions are towards the defense of the dragons, the defense of Kalador, the defense of Ulthuin, and being able to get the dragons to that battle. And so he's a peerless warrior. And so he plays a very active role in the armies of not only Kalador, but also of Ulthuin itself. He leads many a high elf expeditionary force, many a high elf army throughout the world, taking out baddies. And indeed, has appeared in the old world itself, the geographical location, several times, and has declared that he finds Britannia more tolerable than the other kingdoms of the humans in Warhammer. So he's definitely, he vibes a bit with the Arthurian kind of Grail Knights.
Right. And for that reason, you've written them all.
Yeah, I completely. What a douchebag. But it's noted that he has never really forgiven the king who he fought alongside during the kind of siege of Coron, King Charlin, which is Charles with an N instead of an S. And he never forgave that king for taking a good many of his kills that he had kind of thought, oh, I'm, you know, much like the battle or the contest between Gimli and Legolas in The Lord of the Rings about how many you kill.
Oh, yeah.
I saw
one softens them up and the other one swoops in for the...
So Imric on in the tabletop, he is an enormous elven prince on top of an equally enormous blue-white dragon. He's cool. He has what's called the dragon horn. Read into that what you will. But he also has the armor of Kalador, which is one of the suits of armor made during the reign of Anarion. He has something called the Star Lance, which is effectively just a lance whose the speary jabby bit has been made out of a meteorite. Nothing really special. Yeah.
It's pretty special. I mean, do you have one made out of a... Is it a common weapon?
Well, not a spear. It's a fondue fork.
I have other utensils.
It's a fondue fork.
I have a yogurt spoon made out of a meteor.
I have legendary fondues at my house. Yeah. The final character we'll very briefly touch on, because they will appear at a later date, is a being known as Aleth Anar. He is the Shadow King of Nogarivi. So he is the rightful ruler of the Shadowlands of Nogarithi, and is one of the kind of most intransigent enemies faced by Malekith. He is a hunter of dark elves and an archer of supreme capacity, but his greatest kind of skill is that of stealth. His kind of capacity for stealth stems from an artifact he has called the Stone of Midnight. And this is just a brooch that leaks mist. That's effectively what it is.
It's actually defective.
Yeah.
It's not meant to leak anything. But when opportunity strikes, so
he's got this very tiny diesel engine in this brooch that just gives out smog and fog and what have you.
Yeah.
But it's
ironically very loud diesel engine.
Chug, 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 chug.
What is that? Why is it really misty in here? There's definitely not an assassin archer ninja.
The brooch is magical in nature, and the mist that it gives out causes anyone who isn't him to be triggered by their greatest fears and nightmares. So he is a supreme high elf hunter who haunts the dark elves of the Shadowlands and beyond.
Especially if your nightmare is small miniature diesel engines.
He also wears something called the Shadow Crown, which is the crown of the rightful rulers of N'Garoth, and it allows him to kind of bamf out of space and time momentarily and appear somewhere else. So he kind of very much an angry Hawkeye with teleportation abilities and a capacity to make you shit yourself if you get too close. So
he sounds pretty cool.
Yeah,
pretty cool.
Is it? I don't like Hawkeye's band.
Is it Night?
But he's pretty.
Is
cool.
it Nightcrawler? Is the
in yeah the, one of the many in in thing
you can bamf.
So he's got Misty Step. That's his ability. That's one of his abilities.
Yes, exactly right. I think the kind of the greatest piece of lore about him is that he once disguised himself as a dark elf, and the disguise was so complete that he was able to dance with Morathi herself at the court of Malekith with him, you know, present, and he actually stole the mist-producing Stone of Midnight from Marathi's boudoir, from her treasury.
Ooh,
Has since been the, you know, target number one of both Malekith and Morathi in a kind of personal vendetta rather than as a kind of, you know, global idea of taking over Ulthuin. They would abandon their armies to go off and chase him down if word of him got close. Yeah,
that's brilliant.
So he basically, he effectively, when he broke into Nagrond or N'Garoth, he just bypassed every single magical security element that they had and stole the stone. Pretty much just to prove that he could, to prove that Morathi and Malekith were touchable. He could get in and kill them if he wished to at a moment's notice.
And just before he bamfed out, he literally touched her.
Yeah.
And it just went bam. How'd you like them apples, Malekith?
He did that thing where he was standing to her left and just tapped her on the shoulder to her right, and she kind of looked to her right. Yeah. And when she looked back, he was gone.
Yeah. Fucking Kaiser Soze out of there. Bam. How'd you like them? Now, applesauce, bitch.
We're going to skirt over the Shadow King, as Alathanar is called, because we're going to deal with him when we look at the Dark Elves, because him and his line are tied so intrinsically to the post-sundering tale of the High Elves that it makes more sense to cover him in the Dark Elf episodes.
Cool.
But he is one of the few beings that genuinely terrifies Dark Elves. And he leads a cadre of Shadow Warriors who are, if you think, again, we've made reference to him before, if you think of Aragorn as just being angry and moody and an emo all the time, that's all of his followers. They are supreme hunters and fighters, and usually serve as scouts to High Elf armies. But in general, they can be summoned home to his banner and fight as a complete force to take out a Dark Elf kind of settlement using, let's face it, pure terrorist tactics. It's one of these things. The special rules for High Elves and Dark Elves are that the High Elves get a kind of leadership bonus when faced by the Dark Elves, and the Dark Elves hate the High Elves, and hatred comes with special rules. So the Shadow Warriors and the Shadow King are one of the few High Elves that have this kind of hatred mechanic when faced with Dark Elves. So they go above and beyond being just kind of put out that they have evil cousins. They actively go out of their way to shit in their fondues.
And nobody likes a shit fondue.
So, yeah. So, effectively, 3.5 heroes there instead of the full 4. But I do believe we'll be narratively better to look at Alathanar. as part of the Dark Elf episodes. But
hold on, do you mean we did four there? You mean four instead of five?
No, 3.5, because we only covered a little bit of the Shadow
King.
He just mentioned, he just got a shout.
Oh, sorry, was the Shadow King the ninja guy? Yeah. Oh, sorry, I thought you were saying he was a separate dude.
Who is my favourite out of those three characters? He's badass.
Yeah.
He managed to steal the misty stone of dieselness from Marathi.
The diesel engine stone.
All right, okay. It's a mist generating vibrator. That's what it is. That's what we've settled on.
Nice. And you have to start it like a chainsaw. Like a generator.
Stop, I'm trying to be stealthy.
I like the Phoenix Guard dude, the head of them, the kind of
the dickhead.
Yeah, and he kind of he's a reform knobhead. Like, I like that. I'm a bit of a reform knobhead.
A bit.
And you're reformed. Well, sorry, no, you're a knobhead. No, wait a minute. Pick one.
Oh, thanks, guys. Right, we have to wrap up.
Yep.
Is that it?
Yep.
All right, that's all from us. Thank you so much for listening. Details and imagery for the topics we've discussed in this podcast can be found on our website at layingdownthelore.com. We also have all the previous episodes on there, release schedules, merchandise, and you can sign up for the Laying Down the Lore newsletter, which includes exclusive info about upcoming releases, behind-the-scenes chat, and some extra lore not covered in the podcast. Again, if you're keen to support this podcast, just click on the Support Us link in the description and give us all your goddamn spawn-duel. We'll be back again soon, displaying just how little Kral knows about mist-generating diesel brooches. Until then, goodbye.
Cheerio.
Fuck off.